Hello, my name is Claire Michkowski, and I am a member of the Dole Institute Student Advisory Board. Welcome to the Dole Institute of Politics, and thank you for attending today's program. The Dole Student Advisory Board is composed of KU students committed to the work of the Dole Institute. We attend regular meetings, assist in events like this, and plan an SAB-sponsored program every semester. Members of the SAB receive great opportunities to network with our special guests. If you're a student and would like to join, please contact the Dole Institute. The Dole Institute would like to hear from you. If you enjoy today's program, please let us know by contacting us on Facebook, Twitter, or through our website email. Your attendance and feedback help shape future programming. To view past programs, visit our online video archive at www.doleinstitute.org. A video of today's presentation will be available on our website soon. We'd like to encourage each of you to consider becoming friends of the Dole Institute. Do so by returning the brochure on your chair at the end of the program. Our friends help keep our programs free and open and support archive research and our student activities. Before we begin today, I'd like to remind you to please turn off your cell phones. After the presentation, we will have some time for audience questions and answers. If you have a question, please raise your hand and a student helper with a microphone will come to you. Please ask just one brief question. Now, please join me in welcoming Dole Institute Director Bill Lacey.
Thanks, Claire. Thanks to all of you for coming out. We're very proud of this series. It started a few years ago, and it continues to get extraordinary reviews, and we're delighted to provide the venue for it. And I just want to single out Professor Ted Wilson, who's sitting in the back on the back row, hiding from all of us, who actually got us together with Dr. Will Banks from Leavenworth and made this all happen. So you might want to, if you see Ted as you go out, you might want to thank him because he played a role in getting us connected and everything. Dr. John Kuehn is our speaker today. He's the General William Stofft Chair for Historical Research at the U.S. Army Command and General Staff College. He retired from the Navy in 2004. He authored Agents of Innovation in 2008, A Military History of Japan from the Age of the Samurai to the 21st Century, published last year, and co-authored Eyewitness Pacific Theater 2008, as well as numerous articles and editorials. I was just talking to John about this, but his latest book, due out from Praeger just in time for the 200th anniversary of the Battle of Waterloo, is Napoleonic Warfare, The Operational Art of the Great Campaigns. Please welcome Dr. John Kuehn.
Thanks, Bill. Thank you. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. Well, we're not going to talk about Napoleon today. We're going to talk about the Navy, which is near and dear to my heart. To kind of get us started on this topic of naval innovation, I'm going to kind of give a lecture that's going to seem, gosh, this isn't what I usually think about when I think about naval innovation. You know, you think about radars and ballistic missile submarines and stuff like that. Of course, we're going to be in the period between the two world wars. But actually, the vignette I want to start out with is about the Secretary of the Navy, Josephus Daniels, and an innovation that he came up with. I've been studying Secretary Daniels lately. He was Woodrow Wilson's Secretary of the Navy. And if you've got a cup of coffee, it's sometimes you use the nickname Cup of Joe. And that's who it's named after. It's named after Josephus Daniels. He got rid of the alcohol in the officer's mess, in the wine mess. He eliminated the wine mess on the ship. And it's still that way today. We still have wine. It's a wine locker. We only break it out for diplomatic purposes on board naval vessels. But Daniels got rid of it. He was a teetotaler. He was part of the prohibition movement and all that. And so he got rid of it, so the sailors nicknamed his replacement for the wine mess, which is coffee, after Secretary Daniels, and they toast to good old Joe, and that's how it became a cup of Joe. So if you ever wonder about that. But the innovation of his that I want to talk about, although you might say that's an innovation, more of a replacement than an innovation, is the other thing that he did, which was he was very concerned about sailors on board the ships, and he took advantage of new technology, not so much to add to the firepower, but to add to the morale of the ship. And it's an innovation that's still on board naval warships today. And that's the ice cream machine. Josephus Daniels, the new cryogenic technology, refrigeration technology, was out. And on these ships, the battleships, they had new electrical systems. They had electric drive diesels on these things on the latest battleships. And so one of the things, he says, well, why can't we put these refrigerators on and refrigerated units and make ice cream on board the battleships? So he's the guy who installed the ice cream machines on the ships. I don't know how many sailors we have on there, but the we call them the dog machines, because anyway, I won't say why we call them dog machines, but the auto dog machine, the ice cream machine, is still critical to the morale and smooth running of a naval vessel today, and that we also owe that to Josephus Daniels. Okay, well, let's talk a little bit, because you look at this and you go, wow. You know, we think about the U.S. Navy in World War II, and more often than not, you know, we look back and go, okay, well, that was innovative, that was transformational, that was the way ahead. And actually, that's not what these guys, this is the General Board of the Navy, sort of the over general staff, or the great general staff of the Navy, the sort of strategic general staff, sometimes called the balance wheel of the Navy by the naval officers of the period. That's them. And so when you look at that, you think, well, that doesn't look very innovative, a bunch of guys in a room. And this will be a theme, I think, that you'll see in some of the lectures here, is this idea of the general staff, or the modern general staff. And this was sort of the Navy's modern general staff. But they weren't looking back like we do at what happened in World War II. In fact, they were in that room before World War II in 1932. It is in that room. So they didn't know all the things that we know about what happened in World War II and what worked and what didn't work and everything. They kind of had to deal with this. What did they have? What did they understand naval power to be? Well, how did they understand sea power? How did they think about war and everything like that? So, you know, some people have said, well, why don't you have aircraft carriers on the front of your book, you know? And I'm a naval aviator. I've been on 5 aircraft carriers, cruised on that many, and I've flown in jet aircraft and everything like that. But so I think I understand, you know, the technology. But I put these on instead because they were at the time at the General Board, they were relatively new weapon systems themselves, these dreadnought battleships. So I think we need to put ourselves in their shoes and say, okay, where were they, what did they have to deal with, and what were their challenges? So we'll take a look at some stuff on that. I just have some general comments about innovation that I want to deal with first. There's my agenda. I may depart from this, you know, depending on how the time goes and everything, but we'll take a look at a couple case studies here, and then maybe a little comparative stuff, and then we'll take the questions. And I have some general ideas, but I do want to make some sort of general comments about innovation. I got the idea that lack of resources is a pretty good spur towards real innovation, and this is the guy I got the idea from, which is looking at the German army after World War I, and they had been limited by the Treaty of Versailles, and then they managed to come up with all these sort of innovative approaches. They already sort of had an innovative culture. They already sort of had a way of doing business, the German way of war. You can read Rob Santino's works. But this guy kind of took that. He used the really general staff officers, and he was in a constrained by a poverty of resources that were generally dictated on because of defeat of Germany in World War I in the Great War and because of the Treaty of Versailles. And they innovated quite well in the interwar period in a lot of areas, all right, particularly for the challenges he thought Germany might face, all right. And then I thought about the U.S. Navy, and the U.S. Navy, as we'll see, was also constrained by a treaty system, by a series of naval arms treaties. And I got the idea that, you know, maybe these treaties caused innovation. Maybe when we come up with these collective security agreements, they, for some reason, you know, they're meant to sort of delay or constrain, you know, militarism and warlike tendencies. But military professionals still manage to kind of overcome these constraints and innovate and come up with new ways of doing business. Now, if you're going to innovate, if you're going to come up with a new way of doing business, it's not going to do much if nobody accepts it. If nobody accepts, so if you get a great idea but nobody buys it, nobody accepts it, it doesn't go anywhere, and it really kind of goes into the dustbin of almost been, almost had, you know, that kind of thing, type of ideas. So this is patterns of acceptance. There's different ways, and I kind of use this as sort of my model for looking at how innovation gets accepted. You can think of an innovation as a new way of doing business. Normally, here in America, we focus almost exclusively on technology. That technology drives innovation. Technology drives innovation, and when you think about naval innovation or innovation in the Air Force or stuff like that, you're thinking about technology because the weapon systems are almost always these technology-heavy systems, these ships and these airplanes and stuff like that. The human element is a little bit more muted in navies and air forces, and we're talking about navies today. But I think if we think about it as a new way of doing business, that's a better way to do it. And usually when you get a new way of doing business, whether it's technological, whether it's organizational, and I'll spend a lot of time on organizational today, whether it's maybe a tactic, a technology, a new business model, maybe if we want to take it outside the realm of military innovation, normally what happens is it gets shoehorned into an existing way of doing business. Take the machine gun, for instance. The machine gun shows up in the 19th century. What do you do with that thing? Is it artillery? You know, the initial machine guns are pretty big. And is that artillery? What is that? Or should it go to the infantry? They need firepower. What about the cavalry? They need fire. Where does that go? And it sort of gets shoehorned into existing ways of doing business. So that's normally what you see happen first. And we see that a lot today in innovation today. And we saw that with the Navy, too. We'll see that the airplane kind of gets shoehorned into existing ways of doing business. Another way to do it is say, hey, this is so important. This is so unique. It's so different from the way we've been doing business that we really, what we need to do is put it in its own little box. That's called brigading. That's our nickname for that, brigading. That's like strategic bombing. We'll put everything in strategic, we'll put all strategic bombers together, and they'll just do one thing, and they'll be their own organizational thing to do what they're going to do. They tried that with machine guns. It happened during the Franco-Prussian War. The French did that with a really good machine gun they had. And nobody knew about it. It didn't work well with others, and it didn't really help them at all in the war. So sometimes brigading doesn't work out so well. The British tried this with tanks in World War II, and it doesn't work out so well. Another thing is just ubiquity, this is a great example of innovation by ubiquity. You take one of these things and you just flood the market with it. So we see people accepting innovations. Apps are a great example of an innovation, a software innovation. You just flood the market with it and then it kind of creates its own momentum for acceptance. In the military, combined arms. Now, if you were going to use a non-military word for this, I'd say sort of the holistic approach. We're going to take technology, organization, tactics, and we're going to kind of integrate this thing into a sort of a holistic whole approach. And a good example of this is the aircraft carrier. What you end up with is a ship with a composite air wing on board that does many things, not just one thing. And so you sort of get this combined arms naval warfare approach. On land, you might think of all the new tactics and techniques and procedures that were developed for Afghanistan and Iraq for a counterinsurgency, sort of a combined arms approach to kind of deal with the problem. So this is usually the most sophisticated approach, and oftentimes it's the one that's adopted last because it's more complex and it takes more intellectual effort. So those are some ways to think about innovation that I think we needed to talk about up front. This is sort of the bottom line. Even though the innovation has proved its worth, it might have to go through several boxes, you know, before you settle on. And that could change in the future. You might go back to a brigading approach or back away from combined arms and go with a pure approach. More often than not, you tend to go to the more complex approach until the next new thing comes along, right, and then replaces whatever it is. The other thing is the new way of doing business becomes the existing way of business, right? So it becomes sort of the new paradigm, all right? So keep that in mind, all right? Well, let's talk about the Navy. The first thing you got to understand about the United States Navy is it went through an immense amount of change in a very small amount of time. And so you had these reformers. This is Admiral Luce. He creates the Naval War College. This is A.T. Mahan. He sort of comes up with sort of the software for how the Navy should run. And then this is the make it happen guy, Teddy Roosevelt. He's the guy who kind of builds the fleet. And all of this stuff is new. It's all brand new. The Naval War College finally starts to have regular classes only in the 1890s. It's almost disestablished a couple times. Mahan has a hard time running the Naval War College. He's sent back to sea. He's given some poor fit reps. He's told by one admiral that naval officers don't write books, that's not what they're supposed to do. So, and then he builds this thing called the Great White Fleet. That's brand new. The Americans have never had an all-steel battleship fleet before until he comes along. So a lot of change and a lot of time. And then on top of it, you get World War I comes along. And so there's a lot of change. Well, one of the things that happens with innovation that I found, and in naval innovation, is this whole idea of professionalism. And the United States Navy is part of a movement in the United States that begins in the 19th century and really comes into its own in the 20th century, where everybody professionalizes. You get the AMA, you get the nurses, you get teachers, you get all of these organizations that are professionalizing, and the Navy wants to do that too. And they model themselves, believe it or not, on the Prussian General Staff, on the German General Staff. And they tell the Secretary of the Navy after the Spanish-American War, we need a general staff. Well, John D. Long is the Secretary of the Navy, and he says, well, that might be regarded as Prussian militarism, right? That's sort of, Americans don't do militarism, right? They don't do militarism. But you know what? We could have done better if we'd had a body of guys that kind of thought about strategy and did war plans and stuff like that. So he and there was a war strategy board during the war, and he had Mahan on it and everything. And so after the Spanish-American War, he establishes a general board of the Navy, a standing organization as an experiment, all right? So here we've got shoehorning. We're going to kind of shoehorn this organization. We're not going to call it a general staff because Americans don't like general staffs, right? And we'll call it a board because Americans like boards. They like chairman of the board and the school board. And so he calls it the general board. So that's the first big innovation is that we sort of get this secret stealth general staff composed of the hero of Manila Bay, Admiral George Dewey, who turns out to be the perfect pick because he's got so much authority and influence. Who's going to fire George Dewey, you know, and disestablish the general board? And he's in good health. For 17 years, George Dewey's in charge of this experimental ad hoc, could be disestablished at any moment, general staff, all the way up to 1917. This is its job. Now, talk about some loosey-goosey language to allow for all kinds of things to take place. Ensure efficient preparation of the fleet in case of war and for the naval defense of the coast. So there's a lot of loopholes in that language. That's pretty loose guidance, all right? And they don't really give them much more specific than that. So this is the organization that I'm going to kind of focus on today. What happens with this is over time, because of guys like George Dewey, because of World War I, the General Board sort of becomes the go-to organization for designing ships. These are the guys that you go to for ship design. They also do war planning. But in 1915, the United States Navy creates an operational general staff called the Chief of Naval Operations. And so the war planning function goes to this new general staff, the Chief of Naval Operations and his Office of Naval Operations and his staff. But they still have to provide the war plans to the General Board. And the General Board is kind of left with controlling fleet design and the design of ships. And they're sort of the authority that blesses what's going to be built and what doesn't get built. And all the way up until World War II, they're the guys that say, this is how many destroyers we're going to build, this is how many battleships we'll build, this is how many aircraft carriers we'll build, and this is why we're going to build them. And more importantly than that, they prioritize what gets built. So every year, they'll make a priority list. And that's why I call this the General Board as process. What they do is they do these studies, like they'll do a study on aircraft carriers, or they'll do a study on radios, or they'll do a study on submarines. And they'll ask a question, which is kind of where the innovative process starts, usually to solve a particular problem, all right? Usually to solve a particular problem, and we'll see the big problem that kind of drives them here in a second. But then what they would do is they'd get asked a question, they'd make sure it was okay with the Secretary of the Navy, and then they'd come together and meet in their room, and they would invite people to come talk to them about the idea. Like they would invite a political scientist from Columbia University to talk to them about naval arms or arms limitation, or somebody to come and talk about radios, or somebody to come and talk about how the British are doing aircraft carrier design in World War I. And they bring these experts before, and they had these hearings. It was really fascinating. During World War I, they start to keep transcripts of all their hearings, all right? And that was sort of the basis for me getting into this, was looking at all those hearings. Then they go back, they take the study, and they revise it, make a recommendation to the Secretary of the Navy, and that's how they did business. And they would cycle in input from the Naval War College, input from the fleet, input from the Chief of Naval Operations, input from the Secretary of the Navy. As we'll see, they ended up becoming sort of the arms control experts, all right? And I'll talk about that in just a little second. The other thing is they become very political in nature, because they're sort of the guys that are setting the Navy budget every year, and because they're involved in implementing the naval treaty system, they become very, very, very politically connected. They almost become this political military general staff, all right? And they don't wear their uniforms in Washington. They wear civilian clothes like this, all right? So they really sort of become these diplomat admirals, all right, who are doing business between World War I and World War II. The membership had changed over time. Just one thing that I want to point out on this is the Commandant of the Marine Corps is a member of the General Board. Whoever is the President of the Naval War College, William Sims, right after World War I, is a member of the General Board. The Chief of Naval Operations is a member of the General Board. And the Director of Naval Intelligence is a member of the General Board. So these people would show up for the meetings. Sometimes the Naval War College president couldn't come, he'd send his representatives. So a very interesting outfit. In addition to sort of these sort of mandatory members, they also had 5 to 7 other admirals. And these guys varied. If you think about careers, they had some new guys, some old hands, and then maybe one or two guys who were really the senior officers in the Navy. I mean, lineal number, their date of rank was greater than any of these guys, all right? So, but they would be rear admirals. After they had their 4-star job, they would go back to being a 2-star admiral. And they're all wearing, you know, civilian clothes. So it was really kind of collegial, the kind of the way they did business. They would bring some junior officers in. Sometimes they would bring experts in from the fleet. Usually they had a secretary, a commander, and that was usually a really big job. If you were the secretary of the General Board, you were an up-and-comer, and a lot of Navy admirals in World War II had been secretaries of the General Board. Well, that's sort of the relationship between the General Board and everybody else. The Naval War College, membership in the board, the Chief of Naval Operations, membership in the board, and then there was this other piece of the Navy that had been all-powerful prior to World War I, and after the establishment of the Chief of Naval Operations and the General Board, you had these naval bureaus. They started to lose power, but they each had sort of their individual boxes that they worked in. One group did ordnance, okay? They called them the Gun Club, the Bureau of Ordnance. They were the guys who said, these are the kind of guns and armament we need on ships. Another group did engineering. Okay, another group of guys were sort of design guys, construction and repair, and they were professional naval architects. You had a brand new bureau, the Bureau of Naval Aeronautics, BUAIR, all right? And so these guys would also send representatives to the General Board. Then you had the fleet out here, and they would provide input to the General Board as well. So the General Board was sort of a clearinghouse from approximately 1909 until until World War II, it was sort of the clearinghouse for all the high-level ideas and planning that was going on in the Navy. We talked about career paths. Now I want to talk about this. Remember, I talked about Hans von Seeckt and the Germans being limited after World War I by the Versailles Treaty. The Navy kind of did their own Versailles Treaty. We had a Secretary of State named Charles Evans Hughes. He ran for president in 1916 against Woodrow Wilson. Was later Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. But Hughes said, after World War I, we're building too many ships. We just won this huge war against Germany and Austria-Hungary, and we just won this huge war, but we're still having a naval arms race. That makes no sense. So they invited the five major naval powers, the United States, Italy, France, Japan, and the United Kingdom, or Great Britain, to Washington, and they leveraged on themselves, the five nations agreed to all limit themselves on what they could build. And it was kind of like Versailles. The Germans were limited in what they could have by Versailles. The Washington Conference limited all the major naval powers what they could have. And they actually scrapped ships. In fact, one guy joked that more ships were scrapped at the Washington Naval Conference than any naval battle that had ever occurred. So more ships were sunk by the Washington Naval Conference. But it was a huge success because it saved all the participants an immense amount of money. It really stopped the naval arms race dead in its tracks right after World War I. And it limited the battleship. In fact, it said you can't build any battleships anymore. No more battleships. For the next 10 years, nobody could build any battleships. And nobody did. What's amazing here is nobody did. All right. It also said, hey, aircraft carriers, you can take some of those battleships and convert them to aircraft carriers. And aircraft carriers were regarded as this sort of new experimental ship, really a cruiser. And so they allowed some battle cruisers to be converted to aircraft carriers. And they also said, if you do build anything other than aircraft carriers, you could build aircraft carriers up to 23,000 tons, you're limited to 10,000 tons, which really limited you to building cruisers, destroyers, submarines. So it's a fascinating dynamic because it essentially channeled the way people designed and built ships for supposedly the future security environment. All right. Remember, they're not thinking the next war because they thought after World War I, what? No more war, right? So so this system actually gets put into place. There's another conference at London. There's one at Geneva that doesn't work out. And they're constantly trying to expand this sort of limitation on armaments. It's a lot like the nuclear armament stuff that we saw develop after World War II with the Cold War. And it's sort of the same dynamic, too, in terms of spurring innovation in that area. So this really shapes. And who do you think gets to implement this in the United States Navy? That room full of guys in suits, the General Board. They are put in charge of ensuring that the U.S. Navy complies with the Washington Naval Conference, and they're also put in charge of preparing for the next Naval Arms Conference. So right off the bat, they get given all of this authority and influence, and they start to really kind of work hand in glove with the State Department. There's some other key things that happen. One of them is this thing called Article 19. In order to get the Japanese to agree to be two-thirds the size of the United States Navy in terms of their numbers of aircraft carriers and battleships, we agree not to fortify Guam and the Philippines. And the Japanese go, okay, we'll accept that. And that's going to mean that the United States Navy is not going to be able to build any naval bases essentially west of Hawaii to keep the fleet up. All right, so that's one thing. They also put a caveat in there that says, well, because of World War I, we think, and because of the airplane, we think mines, torpedoes, and airplanes are threats. You can modify the battleships that we let you keep for anti-aircraft defense and anti-submarine defense. So that's a loophole that's put into the treaty. And the other thing is they set the limit of the number of aircraft carriers you can build. Essentially, I'm not going to give you the tonnage figures, but essentially Britain has eight aircraft carriers at the end of World War I. Essentially, that's the limit of the aircraft carriers that you can build. So the United States and Japan are allowed to build up, if they want to Britain's numbers. And Britain can scrap her aircraft carriers and build new ones, all right? She won't. She'll keep the old ones, and she won't build any new ones. But Japan and the United States are going to convert some cruisers that they're going to have to scrap, these battle cruisers, into aircraft carriers. So that actually causes Japan and the United States to innovate in aircraft carriers. And again, it's because of naval limitations that does it, that happens. I talked about the General Board. They become the treaty agent. They actually write a naval policy after the Washington Naval Conference saying, here's the new Navy policy based on the treaty. And it's really fascinating. It goes down every category of thing that they're doing, including information, believe it or not. How are we going to shape information? How are we going to deal with radios? Stuff like that. It's a really fascinating thing. The other thing is War Plan Orange, the impact of War Plan Orange. Let me see if I can go forward to War Plan Orange and kind of show you what's going on with that. After World War I, the United States Navy really doesn't have any enemies anymore. They've got this conference where they and Japan have sort of resolved their differences in the Pacific. But on the table, in the planning, the United States has already planned just in case for a war with orange, which is the color code for Japan. The color code for Britain is red, so there's a war plan red, and there's a color code for Germany. Now, war plans are contingency plans. This is not, we're going to fight the British, we're going to fight the Japanese, we're going to fight the Germans. This is, we should have a plan should something go wrong. And so you update these things every year. And actually, we still do that today in the United States. We have war plans. Well, War Plan Orange is the plan for war in the Pacific. Because of the treaty, the United States is not going to have any naval bases to maintain its fleet. And also, the fleet is not based in Hawaii yet. It's based in San Diego, all right? So the fleet is going to have to bring its own logistics with it if it gets involved in a war with Japan. And this will drive how the General Board designs the fleet in the interwar period. And eventually, they'll come up with what we call sea basing today, which is we're just going to have to bring everything with us. We're going to bring our own air bases. Those will be aircraft carriers. We're going to have to bring our own dry docks. These will be these giant floating dry docks, one of which is still in Guam today. An old World War II dry dock is still in Guam today. And we're going to have to bring all of our own oilers, our gas stations, our tenders, our machine shops. And eventually what the United States Navy does is they put their entire logistics tail on ships, and they call it the fleet train. And that's driven by this War Plan Orange, which is in turn driven by the Washington Naval Treaty. And the General Board are the guys who go, this is how we're going to do it. Initially, they thought, well, we'll race out to the Pacific. But they realized they'd run out of gas, literally, if they tried to do that. So eventually, they changed their idea, and they would go island hopping out to the Pacific, all right? Or maybe they'd get lucky, and they'd get a base down in Australia or anything. But that wasn't in the pre-war planning. The plan was, we're going to have to go to war without any allies against Japan if we end up having going to war with Japan, all right? So they designed this War Plan Orange to kind of take everything with them. And that kind of drives how they design everything. So what that does with ship design is it means you're going to have the longest range ships. You're going to have ships that can maintain themselves far away from everything else. So that's how that affected naval design. Let's kind of get back on track here. All right. Well, the top priority initially is battleships. It makes perfect sense. That's why I put the battleships on the cover of the book. The Navy thinks the battleship is the coin of sea power. And there's really been nothing to kind of convince them any different. Because after World War I, the submarine is outlawed as a commerce raider to fight the way the Germans used it. And so everybody kind of thinks submarines are not going to fight that way. They'll go back to being used legally, not as terrorist weapons, but legally. So the battleship, it's like we go, well, why didn't they see the advantages of the aircraft carrier? Well, actually, the aircraft carriers of the 1920s are pretty pitiful. One, the United States only has one, and it only goes 13 knots. It's very small, the Langley. They don't get their big aircraft carriers till the end of the 1920s. Because it takes that long to convert the two battlecruisers because of the parsimony of the Republican administrations in finishing these battlecruisers. And the airplanes can't carry torpedoes. The bombs they can carry are very small. So right now, we don't have those big, powerful airplanes that we're going to have in World War II. We really have these airplanes that are not so effectual. Yeah, they can go out and sink a ship that's anchored in the middle of Chesapeake Bay on a sunny day with no crew and no anti-aircraft guns, and it's already sinking, which is the other story about that. Yeah, they can do that, you know, if you know you set up the operation and bomb it for 2 days in a row. But actually, the airplane is still a pretty weak read in 1930, 1931. Battleship is still the thing. So that's the first thing the Navy does. And what do you think they want to do? We're going to give them new propulsion systems that are going to use oil, not coal. That'll free them up to go farther and faster and to keep up, all right? We'll also make it so they can defend themselves against airplanes. So we'll do some things with armor and with anti-aircraft guns, all right? Also, when we put these new propulsion systems in and go over from coal to oil, we'll make it so we can counter-flood the ship. You know, we can transfer the oil around just like we would counter-flood with water in the bilges and everything, and that way we can keep the ship stable and steady so that we can keep it afloat. And one of the reasons most of the battleships are saved at Pearl Harbor is because of these modifications, in addition to damage control that we come up with for some of this. All right. So that's the first thing we do as we work. And they're sort of, but once these changes are done, you can't build any new battleships. It's kind of like, okay, now what do we do? And I think you guys have heard the old rule, you know, work expands to fill the time allotted to it. And so the general board goes, well, now what do? Well, they start to look at all the other things: aircraft carriers, destroyers, submarines, the fleet train, logistics ships, floating dry docks. And so because of the naval treaty, they kind of set the battleships over here. So we've taken care of them, and they start to think about everything else. Airplanes. They think about airplanes constantly. In fact, the guy who's in charge of the Bureau of Aeronautics says, hey, I need 1,000 airplanes. And that's the one program that always gets funded, by the way, are these airplane programs. So they put a lot of effort in this, all right? They actually use some of the scrapped ships from the Washington Naval Treaty to kind of do testing to see what works and what doesn't work. And the Ostfriesland, the sinking of the German battleship Ostfriesland by Billy Mitchell, actually kind of contributes to this. They kind of go, oh, well, maybe, you know, we need to take this guy seriously. Let's take a look at what really sinks ships when you bomb them with airplanes. And so they did all these tests and made all these improvements to the ships. And then they were folded into the Maryland. Now, the Maryland is one of the ones that sunk and was never raised, right, at Pearl Harbor? No, she settled nicely, raised. So a lot of these things actually came in handy at Pearl Harbor because the ships had really good damage control systems. Okay, we don't think about these things. Okay, I talked about the orange strategy and the fortification clause, so I don't need to kind of go on that. And there's the thing about the battleships being raised. The other thing about battleships is, of course, we always say, well, the battleship is obsolete in 1921, which is why they're still pounding the beach in Kuwait in 1990 and 1991, right? So anyway, sometimes we want to write weapon systems off, and history doesn't back us on that. Now, this is one of the really interesting stories. This is not actually in the book. This, I had one of my students do this, is submarines. So submarines are not going to be terrorist ships that cruise around and sink, you know, merchantmen. They're not going to sink neutral shipping. They're not going to be used like they were used in World War I. And everybody agrees, we'll never do that again, right? We've got the submarine protocol, the Washington protocol, the London protocol, and we'll never do that. But because of War Plan Orange, the United States says we need long-range submarines to serve as the eyes of the fleet and to do reconnaissance for it. So what happens is the U.S. submarines sort of become accidentally really good commerce raiding ships. All right. So they're not designed to go out and sink the Japanese merchant fleet. They're designed to go all the way across the Pacific on sustained patrols, armed to the teeth with 6 torpedo tubes in front and 4 in the back, able to mount 3-inch gun and then a 5-inch gun. And then they put air conditioning on these submarines because they're going to operate in the between the tropics of Cancer and Capricorn. So they're going to be in the tropics. All right. And so the U.S., submarine design. Initially, though, there's a disaster. They design these V-class submarines, and these things are huge. They're almost, some of these things are like the size of a destroyer. In fact, one of them we kind of use as a special operations boat during the war because you can fit so many people on it. You can put like a company of Marines on it and land them at Macon, or we use another one in the torch landings, all right? But these are sort of a transition class, but from these, we design the Tambor and the Gato classes. And then these long-range submarines, on the day that we get attacked at Pearl Harbor, they get unleashed on the Japanese. Now, problem is their torpedoes don't work, all right? So the Japanese don't know how much danger they're in. But that's another outgrowth. And the general board is intimately involved in the design of these things, constantly saying, well, this is what we need to do. Well, this isn't working out. Let's make them a little smaller. Let's put air conditioning on them. And they actually create a sub-board headed by Admiral Thomas Hart, who's a submariner, that kind of looks at these things to make sure they get the design right. And that's why we end up with such a good submarine in World War II to do the terrorist, illegal submarine warfare that we eventually use against the Japanese. Well, I've talked a little bit about aircraft carriers and naval air. A lot of people forget, naval air is not just planes flying off of aircraft carriers. I was fortunate in my naval career to fly both land-based and carrier-based aircraft. And so the Navy doesn't know, are we going to be able to build long-range airplanes that are going to obviate carrier aircraft and make carrier aviation perhaps obsolete? Are we going to use seaplane tenders? What about aircraft? And the United States has problems building the aircraft carriers during the interwar period. We really don't start to build them until the 1930s in any numbers, all right? And that's after Japan pulls out of the treaty system, all right? So there's all these problems. And there's also a loophole in the London Treaty that says maybe you can put some airplanes on cruisers. And the guy who's in charge of the Bureau of Aeronautics goes to the general board and he goes, we need to get aviation to the fleet. And he comes up with this fascinating design. Basically, Admiral William Moffett says, why don't we have something called the flying deck cruiser? And this is the design for it. And we almost get the angle deck aircraft carrier 20 years before it actually appears because of this design. The problem is, in 1932, when they set the money aside to build this experimental ship, which is sort of the front end of it is a cruiser and the back end of it is an aircraft carrier with an angled deck so that it won't interfere with the gun directors on the forecastle of the ship, there's no money. And we say, well, let's put it off until next year. You know, and maybe we'll have the money then. Well, a new president comes in, and he says, why don't we wait another year? And they keep putting it off. In fact, Ernest King, who takes over for Moffett after Moffett's killed in an airplane accident on an airborne aircraft carrier, a Zeppelin called the USS Akron, where he's thinking, well, maybe we can put aircraft carriers in the sky. Ernest King takes over, and he wants to build this thing all the way up until 1939. Ernest King is saying, build it, build it, build it. It's only $20 million. We'll find out all kinds of interesting things. We never build it, and we never get the angled deck aircraft carrier until the Korean War. All right? That's fascinating. What would have happened? By the way, this is what the Russians, the Soviets, actually built during the Cold War, is something that looks almost exactly like this, the Kiev-class carriers. So very innovative design, designed in 1930s. And again, the general board was totally behind this to build this thing, but they couldn't get the money to build it. Nobody would give them the money. The final thing is sort of this logistics piece. And again, I focused on, hey, we got to bring everything with us. Well, one of the things that, let me go back to this. One of the things that the Orange Plan was predicated on was the writing of Alfred Thayer Mahan. And Mahan had said that a fleet is going to lose 10% of its fighting power for every 2,000 kilometers it advances. That was sort of a rule that he came up. Now, that rule was come up with in 1903 for coal-fired steamships, all right? But everybody kept using the same rule. Well, the reason he came up with that rule is he said, over time, the machinery breaks down inside the ship, and marine life builds up on the hull of the ship. So you have to go into harbor, work on the machinery with it turned off. Obviously, you can't do that in the middle of a battle or in the middle of an operation or deployment. And you also have to scrape the marine life off the hull. Now you go, well, what's the big deal with that? It slows the ship down, and speed is essential. You need speed and hitting power and reliable propulsion. Well, what do you do to do that? And what the general board does in the early 20s is they say, you know what? The treaty does not let us build battleships. The treaty only will let us build so many aircraft carriers. But the treaty doesn't limit us on building floating dry docks. So what we'll do is we'll build these giant mobile floating dry docks. And those things will take care of the ships. And this is actually 1944 off of Espiritu Santo, which is about 300 miles southeast of Guadalcanal. And that's the West Virginia, the battleship that was sunk at Pearl Harbor, in there getting trimmed up prior to the Battle of Leyte Gulf, where it helps destroy the Japanese fleet at the Surigao Strait. These things are envisioned during the interwar period by the General Board. In fact, they're the number one priority. And what's fascinating here is they're not seen as warships. They're like, well, we can build these things because they're not militaristic. They're not offensive weaponry, right? And so then now initially the General Board builds the smaller ones, but in a year where President Hoover doesn't build a single warship, he builds floating dry docks for destroyers. So it's fascinating how they kind of pitch these things to kind of drive through these loopholes in the treaties, just like the Germans did with the Treaty of Versailles, kind of figure out how to do things. And this is a general staff that's kind of orchestrating all of this. There's a kind of a picture of sort of what does the interwar navy look like right on the brink of Pearl Harbor. And that's a giant floating dry dock there. Okay. Comparisons. I want to go back. Well, what about the British and the Japanese? I don't want to spend too much time on this because I've mostly been looking at this issue of American naval innovation. I want to give you guys some chances for some questions here. But these guys are innovating too. The United States is not innovating in a vacuum. Okay, Great Britain probably innovates least successfully, but they still innovate. One of the most innovative secret weapons of World War II, which is created as a logistics ship because Great Britain thinks she's going to have to go through unimproved beaches in the Mediterranean to fight Italy, is something called the landing ship tank. And the British come up with that in the 1930s. And they have the blueprints, and they give them to the United States, and we build several thousand of them during World War II. All right. So Britain does do some innovation, but she's limited by what she can do. She's limited by what she can do. And I can talk more about that maybe some other time. Japan has this inferiority complex, but she knows the United States is going to have to come out to fight her. So she designs her fleet to kind of be a one-shot fleet. We're going to defeat the United States, and the United States is going to go, okay, we give up, you win, all right? Pearl Harbor is not that defeat. Pearl Harbor was never meant to kind of be that defeat. Pearl Harbor was just meant to keep us on our butts until Japan could seize all the resources of the Southeast Asia basin. But Japan is going to equalize things by training. So it's not just technology, but she's going to train. In fact, Japan is going to become the best night fighting navy in the world. And that's one of the things she does. She also develops naval aviation. But her goal is decisive naval battle. It's totally focused on this eventual battle of the two giant fleets, primarily their battleships. And Japan will never really let go of that. If you notice, she's always kind of sending her aircraft carriers out first and holding her battleships back in World War II. And that's because in the interwar period, that was going to be her decisive main effort. We're going to be all those battleships, all right? And so she kind of designs her whole fleet around those things. And she's got plenty of those things in 1944. What she doesn't have anymore of are aircraft carriers and naval aviators. So that kind of shapes what she does. But I kind of give Japan a B+. All right? If the British get a B- or a C+, the Japan gets sort of a B+. Germany is a fascinating case because just like her army, her navy is also limited by the Treaty of Versailles. And what is Germany going to build? Is she going to build a mechanized army? Is she going to build an air force? Is she going to build battleships and submarines and aircraft carriers? And what does Hitler say to all of that? Yes. So there is no prioritization. But given the fact that they really don't strategically prioritize, they do a pretty good job. And they absolutely prepare for that submarine war. And so they catch everybody by surprise because they really kind of innovate. And even though they're not allowed to have submarines, they design them in other people's countries. They build them for the Dutch. And they actually uh, they actually practice U-boat wolfpack tactics with torpedo boats on the surface, because that's how Dönitz is going to use U-boats. As essentially, they'll surface at night and attack as like a torpedo boat flotilla at night. And that's how he designs his tactics. His great Achilles heel, of course, is communications. And you guys, if you've seen The Imitation Game, you can kind of see why that's an Achilles heel. Nobody will be able to read our communications. That's probably not a good assumption for Dönitz to have made. But it was a reasonable assumption, all right? I mean, Turing says, this is an impossible code to break, and we're going to break it, okay? So, but it took a genius to kind of do that. But Germany is a fascinating case, and I give her kind of a B+ too, because she does a lot with very, very little. And I mean, if you listen to Winston or Churchill, the thing that bothered him most during the war was the U-boat. That's what he said. He said, the U-boats kept me awake at night. All right, the U-boats kept me awake at night. So those are some of the comparisons, and you can do some more. Just some final conclusions, and then I'll open up for some questions, is you sort of get this ideological transformation as you kind of go from World War I to World War II. And people start to think about sea power differently. Okay, up to World War I, you hadn't really thought about sea power projecting power in any other way than just kind of landing an army on somebody's home soil, all right? But now you're starting to get these long-range weapons and aircraft. So you sort of get this ideological transformation that occurs in sea power. And so that's innovative. And my argument is the General Board kind of understands that. You freeze lessons learned from World War I. The Washington Naval Treaty kind of freezes. What often happens is there's a war, and there's all these lessons learned. And what's the first thing militaries do? Forget the lessons learned, right? Well, the Washington Treaty kind of freezes those lessons learned and don't build, they're not, you can't build any battleships. You have to build, you can build submarines and you can build aircraft carriers and destroyers and cruisers and airplanes, all right? So the Washington Treaty kind of has this strange influence, not intended, of kind of freezing these lessons learned from World War I in place. And of course, organizations as weapons. You know, these staffs, these thinkers, these guys, that they don't have a lot of stuff. Okay, they don't have a lot of money, they don't have a lot of ships, but they have a lot of time, and they're organized, and they think about the problems conceptually. And when they don't have something to play with, they kind of walk through it mentally. So organizations as weapons. And then finally, sort of the Navy, the U.S. Navy and the diplomatic instrument of power, we see navies really kind of coming into their own as instruments of diplomatic power. I kind of talked about all these already. I think that's probably good enough. Why don't we kind of open it up for some questions? I'll take some questions now. Yes, sir.
In all my research, I haven't found anywhere where the Germans had any aircraft carriers.
No, and what happened with that is Hermann Göring's attitude was, if it flies, it belongs to me. You sort of had the same problem in the British side with the air ministry kind of controlling and the British kind of having the fleet air arm as this sort of ignored thing. And he kind of had the same thing going on in Germany. And what Hermann Göring did was he said, well, I'm going to control the aviation side of the business. And so the Navy had to come to him to get air power. They never built the aircraft carrier. They had the Graf Zeppelin that they were building under the so-called Z plan, which was going to give Germany sort of this combined arms Navy by about 1946. The problem was the Navy couldn't go to war until 1946. And all the German admirals, if they agree on anything, it's that we weren't ready for war in 1939. The Navy that we wanted, you know, we weren't going to get until 1946. And they were supposed to get aircraft carriers. Friedrich Ruge, who becomes sort of the first chief of naval operations of the West German Navy after the war, the Bundesmarine, he says basically, well, the Germans always like to experiment. And so our huge problem with the aircraft carriers, we never built one and experimented with it in peacetime. Otherwise, we would have seen how useful it was and we would have built it. But my take on it is maybe, but Göring is still going to control, you know, the weapon. In fact, the Luftwaffe had a better torpedo than the German Navy did. The Luftwaffe actually had a better torpedo. But that had a pernicious effect on building it. And they never did give that thing. In fact, I think they used it to evacuate Kurland or something. But eventually, it's sunk next to the pier. It never flies any sorties. Another question. Yes, sir.
When did Japan break the Washington Treaty?
Well, they don't break it. The Washington Treaty basically says, if you want to pull out of this thing, you have to give us 2-year notification. So if you give us 2-year notification, 2 years after you provide notification, you can start to build whatever you want. Okay? So it's a gentleman's agreement. And there's no mechanism for enforcement. Everybody's sort of relied on to kind of, because these are the victorious allies of World War I. They're all liberal democracies, right? Japan is a constitutional monarchy. It's got Taisho democracy. And so, you know, everybody kind of trusts everybody else. The whole system is based on trust. And what happens when the Japanese army disobeys orders, well, they don't disobey orders, they just kind of make up their own orders and invades Manchuria in 1931, there's a big brouhaha, and the fallout from this is that Japan sort of gets criticized by the League of Nations, and she walks out of the League of Nations. At the same time, she had signed the London Naval Treaty, where she'd agreed to additional limitations on all the auxiliary ships, submarines, destroyers, and one of the limitations was, we'll do like we did with battleships, we'll only have 2/3 as many cruisers as the United States has. And that treaty is immensely unpopular with the Army and the Navy. It's very popular with the Japanese public, but it's very unpopular. And so a prime minister is assassinated, a couple admirals are assassinated and everything after the London Treaty. So by 1932, Japan is on a clear course towards militarism. And after she kind of is, the report comes out from the League of Nations castigating her for the Manchurian invasion and refusing to recognize Manchukuo as a state. Japan walks out of the League of Nations and she provides 2 years notification she's pulling out of the Washington Naval Treaty. The other thing is that Franklin Roosevelt says, well, we're going to build to treaty limits in the United States. Now, he does that really as a jobs program for the Great Depression, the National Industrial Recovery Act. So that passes. And so that just further solidifies the Japanese feelings to pull out of the treaty system. But they don't do anything illegal. It's a myth that they cheat, rabidly, rampantly, that they build up all their bases. They spend all their money on ships. They're not spending money on improving the bases in Micronesia. So, you know, yeah, this whole idea that Amelia Earhart and Pete Ellis go out there and discover the Japanese secretly fortifying these islands is a complete myth. They do some minor things. They cheat on their cruiser sizes a little bit. You know, but it's not anything worse than the United States Navy, what we're doing in terms of loopholes. So there's loopholes. There's squishy room. Okay. So they leave the treaty officially by 1935. They're starting to build ships that are not limited by the treaty. Yep. Yes, sir.
During this period, were there any significant advances in naval gun fire control systems?
You know, that was a huge part of the battleship modernization program, and it also spurred the development of naval aviation. What happened, the big problem with firing at long ranges is, how do you correct your fall of shot? And the farther away and the faster things are moving, you really need the kind of real-time communications that we have today. And so they were, and one, how do you spot the fall of shot? I mean, a crow's nest on one of these battleships, let me kind of see if I can bring the picture up. The crow's nest on one of these things is probably only going to give you a line of sight out to 12 or 13 miles, all right? And you've got the point now with these things that you can go 30,000 yards, 35,000 yards with some of these guns. So naval aviation gets a huge spur from Moffett and from Sims, because they're going to use the airplanes as the crow's nest. And they'll put radios on the airplanes, and then they can relay. The other thing is they've got something that gets invented called the forward range finder, which is essentially a differential equation machine to kind of solve the moving target problem of, I'm moving, he's moving, how do I correct my shot so I can zero in? So in naval battles, you always kind of see the first couple shots miss, and that's why you're kind of registering. But it's not like in land warfare where you've got fixed targets. These are moving targets, all right? So all the technology is there. The biggest weakness is the communications. And one of the loopholes in the Washington Naval Treaty is the battleship reconstruction clause. The United States says, well, in order to get longer ranges, because now that we have airplanes that can be range finders for the battleships, we need to alter our turrets so that they can get a higher trajectory of fire and longer range. And so that actually causes the General Board to say, yeah, naval aviation is critical to the way that we see it.
So there's a lot that's done on that. But the biggest weakness is communications. Biggest weakness is going to be communications. We won't see that many long-range engagements, really, in World War II. We'll, again, because of that problem. All right. Tom.
Yes. If you look at the Naval General Board and CNO complex, and at the U.S. Army General Staff in the same period, 1920s, 1930s, are there any significant differences in structure and function between those two entities, Naval General Staff, Army General Staff?
Well, the board is kind of limited in its ability to grow. It really is. It's really not going to ever be more than about 15 guys, all right? Now, there'll be 15 really bright guys, all right? But with the Army General Staff that's created by the root reforms and with the Chief of Naval Operations, you get all of sort of the bureaucratic stuff that happens. The staffs get bigger and bigger and more complex, all right? Now, they'll shrink in wartime, but they'll grow again. General Board never grows. It really is stable in terms of its size. And a hypothesis I have is that's one of the reasons it's so effective, is because it's sort of got that limitation on creating a bloated bureaucracy, which can sometimes cause friction to innovation. All right. Now, it gets disestablished, you know, in 1950. After the war, everybody in the Navy goes, you know what, that General Board was a pretty useful thing to have in the interwar period. And so they take Arleigh Burke and they take John Tower, who's a naval aviation guy, very, very innovative guy, kind of runs the training program for naval aviation during World War II that trains all our pilots. And they sort of rejuvenate the General Board after 1945. But there's this big battle between the Navy and the Air Force after the National Security Act in 1947. And the General Board gets disestablished in the big brouhaha called the Revolt of the Admirals in 1949. So it's sort of seen as this kind of locus for insubordinate naval officers, and it's done away with in 1950. We don't need those guys anymore. We've got the Joint Chiefs of Staff and the Joint Staff and everything like that. So they disestablished the General Board in 1950. But it's kind of part of that sort of disciplining of the Navy that occurs in 1948, 1949, 1950. See Ted kind of laughing back there. It's an interesting dynamic. John goes into it in some of his books too. Okay. Did I answer your question?
Oh, yes.
Okay. All right. Yes, sir. 1 minute. One last question. One last question. Yes, sir.
Why didn't the United States and the Canadians work more closely together with coastal patrols prior to and just after the beginning of World War II? And why wasn't the Navy given that responsibility instead of the U.S. Air Force?
You know, this is for World War II, right?
Yeah.
Well, one of the problems is we don't go to war with the Japanese and the Germans until 2 years after the Canadians and the Commonwealth go to war with them. So, in fact, more than 2 years, all right? So that's one of the problems, all right? And Congress passed something called the Neutrality Act, right? So there's some real limitations on the sort of cooperation that we can do, not just with Canada, but with Australia. I mean, if the General Board had known that Australia is going to be this giant advanced base, they may have worked a little less hard in designing this long-range power projection fleet that they designed. But once FDR makes his Four Freedoms speech, which is, I forget, 1940 that he makes that speech, he really starts to kind of say, okay, guys, there's the Quadrant Conference, we start to work it. But I mean, they're at war with the Germans in the Atlantic. Luckily for us, the Germans don't have a lot of U-boats, and they they're hoping for a short war, so they kind of have to take an operational pause to kind of get their U-boats back up to speed in 1941. But once they start coming out again in 1941, the Canadians really kind of pick up the slack there. But once the United States and Canada start working together, it's really amazing what happens. The United States, in fact, because of labor laws, will use Canadian yards to build a lot of the shipping in World War II because they're not limited up in Canada. Now, what's fascinating is Canada's going to have this horrible unemployment after the war as all these shipyards are disestablished, okay? But the United States actually didn't overbuild in terms of capacity and everything like that. But the Canadian, the Royal Canadian Navy really is kind of in the gap there. The United States Navy participates. I mean, they call it the neutrality patrol. And there is quite a bit of cooperation, but it doesn't get written about much. But the short answer is they go to war in 1939 and we go to war in 1941. That's the short answer. The more complicated answer, I think. Okay. And that's it. Thank you so much.